Hey, I guess we can continue. I hope you enjoyed your fika. Let's give a round of applause to our next speaker, Ryan, from Anocca. And Anocca is our sponsor, so thank you very much, Anocca, for making PyCon 22 possible. Let's give a round of applause. So, please.
All right. Thank you very much for the opportunity to actually sponsor, which would be, we're very thankful for that. Right, so I am the Chief Information Officer at Anocca, but I'm actually a scientist by training. I have a PhD in biochemistry in an area called synthetic biology. And through a random series of events, I ended up being a developer and running the developer team at Anocca. I've been there for about 8.5 years since it started. Now, our tagline is engineered immunity, and hopefully by the end of this you'll have some understanding of what that means. And obviously the title of my talk was Working Smarter to Fight Cancer Using Dunder Special Methods to Automate Code Generation. Not a combination of words I imagine you would hear in your lifetime. So let me work through that and get to the end of it. The first third or so is going to be talking about Anocca and some of the science to set the scene, and then I promise we'll get into some Python. Okay, we work at Anocca in an area of biology called the adaptive immune system. And you might be wondering, what is that? Well, it's in the name, it's adaptive. It's the part of your immune system that changes and evolves and has memory of all your experiences throughout your life and your environment and yourself. We all change through our lives. And your adaptive immune system is capable of detecting you from everything else, right? Many of you are probably familiar with vaccines these days. This is actually a technological means to pre-program the adaptive immune system, and it is one of the single most amazing technologies that humanity has actually had, antibodies being the others. But vaccines are about making antibodies largely. And antibodies, again, something you've probably heard of, are a product of the immune system, and they're about viral clearance and bacterial clearance from your blood, largely. They do a good job of that. What they're not good at is taking out cells that are actually infected with that virus, right? That's the job of these things called T cells. And I've called them the silent foundation of the adaptive immune system because I imagine most people have no idea what a T cell is. They actually make up a significant portion of your white blood cells, about a third, give or take. They come in two flavors. The first one is soldiers. This is probably the one that you learnt in high school, I imagine. And their role is to hunt down and kill cancerous cells or infected cells. The other flavor are the quote-unquote officers. They're the command and control. They coordinate the adaptive immune system. So when you get cancer, it's when your soldiers stop doing their job. And when you get autoimmune disease, largely speaking, it's about your officers not doing their jobs. And so if you can understand T cells, you can make better therapies, you can make better vaccines, vaccines that you only have to take one shot instead of 3, 4. You can make it so that your vaccines produce better antibodies. But you can also harness the T cells themselves so that you can target cancer better. And hopefully, in the future, we'll also understand how officers work and we can treat autoimmune diseases. So as you might imagine, T cells are pretty cool, but they're also very, very difficult to work with or to understand. T cell biology is complex. In fact, it's very, very complex. In order to harness T cells therapeutically, it's a three-part problem. And bear with me here. We're going to get into some biology. It's the HLA, the antigens, and the T cell receptors, or TCRs. The first part is the HLA challenge. There are about 13,000 known human variants of the HLA genes, but you only have six of them. There are actually more than six genes, but for this talk, it's six. And they come from your genetic lineage, right? And HLAs can only present a certain number of antigens, right? So your immune system is only capable of presenting certain parts of the entire universe, so to speak, right? What's an antigen? Good question. An antigen is basically a very small part of proteins, the machinery that make life work, yours and everything else you encounter, you eat, everything you get infected with, everybody you touch, they're all presented these things called antigens. And strictly speaking, it's practically infinite, but if we wanted to put a number on it, it's somewhere between 20 to the power of 12 and 20 to the power of 20. Grain of salt with that one. The last part, well, I should say, the way your body talks to your immune system is through that HLA antigens. Your body is constantly, every cell in your body except for red blood cells, is constantly presenting to your immune system the state of that cell in time and space. The way your immune system senses that is through this thing called a TCR. And I would love to spend an hour, probably more, to be fair, on the TCR, because that biology is so amazingly cool. But I can't. So suffice it to say that the way a T cell works is it makes its own version of its TCR when it is created. It has its own unique gene. And this is quite unique to T cells, except for one other cell type, which we won't go into. There are around 10 to 18 potential unique TCRs that a human can produce. And to put that in context, right now, today, a healthy adult, you would have made a few hundred million T cells. Every single one of them has a unique TCR. So it would take about a million lifetimes to produce the same TCR. And it gets more complex than that, because your TCRs and your T cells are trained and selected against your HLAs and your antigens. So you can't just take a TCR from a T cell and transplant it into another person, because you're likely to kill them, because it'll go, you're not me. But because we're all human, we all have this commonality, right? We're all unique, but we're all the same. Interesting. There is overlap between them, right? Especially in certain population groups. So to get into a sticky point, Caucasians tend to have something called A0201, around 50% of us. So if you can find a TCR that targets that and a specific antigen, you can transplant it from one person to the next. If that TCR isn't going to attack all the other five HLAs, right? It's a really hard problem, and of course I'm here today to tell you we solved it, obviously. Right, so Anocca's platform addresses all three problems. Very quickly, the way we did it is that we actually engineered programmable cells. These are based on human cells. They don't go into humans, it's purely for the tech side of things. We alter the genomes of these. We remove the genes for HLAs and TCRs to create blank cells. It's like going into an operating system and deleting a bunch of processes. Then we stick in these things called standardized genetic cassettes, which are backdoors or Trojans to the operating system of a cell. And that allows us to sideload custom programs or custom genetic sequences to encode the specific HLA that we're interested in and the specific antigen that we're interested in. And likewise, we can do the same thing with TCRs. So when you combine that together, and it's all built modular, by the way, we can do this. We can discover antigens, and we can discover TCRs, and we can discover which context, which HLA context it is. And then we rearrange this modular technology, and we use it in a different way, and we can validate that a particular TCR targets a particular antigen and a particular HLA, and it actually does it well enough to be useful. But more importantly, we can discover which human it can go into, right? We can determine you can put it in this person, but you definitely can't put it in that person if they have that HLA. And just for the techies, we can actually engineer them to make them better. So there are three parts that make Anocca. We have our precision functional assays. Don't worry about that. That's what we just talked about. But more importantly, we started off with the idea that we want to scale this, because this problem is really hard, and you have to do it at scale. So it's all built to be modular, it's standardized, and we can automate, and we are automating it. And of course, talking today, advanced software solutions. Sorry about that, that's the marketing speak. We build our own software platform to run all this, to make it work, to capture the data and do all the analysis, or at least we're in the process of. So software is critical to our scale-up and the automation of the workflows and the data management, and it underpins and is integral to the entire platform. Again, marketing speak, it's called Anocca-OS, externally speaking, but more importantly to this audience, it's built with scalable architecture, so it's modern best practices, you know, it's all cloud-based compliant, and we are continuously developing it all the time. It covers practically everything, so inventory, laboratory protocols, process and automation, data capture and storage, processing analysis, visualization, and optimization. And I would love to be able to show you some of that, but unfortunately, I can't. But what I can tell you is how we build it. So our tech stack is, well, we're here about Python, so it's Python-based, largely on the back end. Django is our major framework for our web application. We use Graphene and Graphene Django. With a PostgreSQL backend. And the reason we use Graphene Django is to create a GraphQL API, which I'll talk about very quickly for anyone that's not aware of it. And the front end is TypeScript, Apollo, and React. Now, I have a leaning towards Python and the backend side of things, so that's why it's blue and pretty, and the other side is a little bit more. Of course, the whole thing is Dockerized, containerized, virtualized, all those lovely things, and orchestrated by Kubernetes. We also make use of Mini.io. Instead of AWS. Okay, what is GraphQL? Looking at the time there. All right, here we go. So GraphQL stands for Graph Query Language. It is not a graph database, just FYI. I really like that talk, by the way. It stimulated some ideas. But anyway, it's strongly typed, deterministic, and predictable, mostly. And one of the key differences is that it has a single URL endpoint, and it's just slash GraphQL, that's it. So it's very different to REST in that regard. One of the cool things is it's self-documenting, but more importantly, it should be an extra bullet point, clients are enabled to fetch specifically which data they want. And I'll show you an example. It's split into two separate things called queries and mutations, and it uses a function-like syntax. So this is an example of a query. People from the REST world will know that as a get. And this is what the client would craft. So for example, get HLAs. We have up here, this is a client side. They are crafting a function that they can pass in attributes. It's typed. And that maps to the attributes that the backend provides, that the API actually provides. This is a list query. And these are the specific values that it wants to return. And because it's a graph, you can go into relationships, and you can specifically select which ones as long as the API is exposing it. The variables are piped in with a JSON structure, and again, like I said, it's actually typed. Please pay close attention to the where. That's something that we do. And then the return type, as I said, it's quote-unquote predictable, because the way you craft and the way you send in your statement is what the backend will return. So it's actually deterministic in that regard. So main is, well, HLAs is aliased as main, and then we have Anocca ID, HLA donors, so on and so forth. Mutations are identical. The only real difference is that you change the keyword, the keyword to mutation, and you can only access the mutation backend functions. Again, query variables, and you get the response exactly the same. This extension cache parameters and all this metadata, that's Anocca's modification to GraphQL itself using the extensions keyword. So Anocca's GraphQL is very large and very complex. We have thousands of objects and types, tens of thousands of fields, and we've built in this advanced query SQL-like statements so that people can be interesting with our data. So in order to do that, we actually focused on schema generation. When we first started, it was literally me who was doing this, and then I got another guy, and we were a team of two for a few years, and now we're at 6-7 people. So we had to work smarter. We couldn't just brute force it to make it work. Now, I said we work with Django, and so we spent a lot of effort into making our Django models fat. Some people might frown upon that, but they are very comprehensive models. So we didn't want to spend all that time and effort doing it on the API either. So we extended the GraphQL model form, the model form. If anyone's familiar with Django, you'll know what that means. And we built our own something called a core object type. Now, this thing is never instantiated, it's always subclassed. When it's instantiated, when it's subclassed, at runtime, it automatically generates three extra classes based on the model. And I'll show you how that works in a second. So we do not write that code. It's generated automatically for us. The mutation, single query, and list query subclasses do something similar. We hook them into these two things. And for the, in the case of the mutation, we use the model form to actually build the query, to build the attributes for the GraphQL functions. And it'll automatically generate a form query at runtime for us. These are all plugged directly into another class that we subclass. That's why we use the term mixin. And again, when it at runtime, it actually generates the schema for us. And so that's a lot to absorb, I get it. I'll give you a few very brief examples of what I mean by this. And this is our real code, by the way. So if anyone's familiar, it's a bit hard to read, but anyway. This is the core type. And we call it HLA core type, subclass this. This is the only thing that is actually graphing. Everything else is abstracted out. We have a class meta. We define which model this thing is supposed to be on, whether it's authorized. And then we just give it a list of fields that we want to create based on the model that we're passing in. We can do the flat ones, but we also do relationships. Credit where credit is due, this is done by graphing Django. The filters is ours. And again, we just use the same pattern, pass in some fields, some strings, and it automatically generates stuff. The one graphing field that we have to define a resolver. This is how you would make a single item fetch. This is it. It's 5 lines of code. We say it's this core type. This is the query set. That's the Django side of things. And then there was an additional argument. So if we didn't have that extra argument, it would be even less. The list query is the same, so even simpler. So if we went back here, oh, too many things. All right. Oh, there it is there. So that this whole thing is generated by those 3 lines of code. Oh, didn't think that through, did I? Okay, form mutations, same deal. We define a form, hook it into the model. That's pure Django. And then the create mutation, you can see the pattern happening here, right? It's exactly the same. Hook in the core type, add the form. Maybe we had some form query args, and away we go. These are very simple versions. Of course, we have the ability to do much more complex things. But for the sake of this talk, this is the point. The schema definition, that's it. It's 10 lines of code. And one of them we don't actually need. We actually need to take that out. So this is all it does. We import queries, the mutations, and the schema object mixin. We put it together. And then it automatically generates these things. So at runtime, it will create those types, the 4 queries and 2 mutations. And notice nowhere in that code did I define the names of these things. It's all purely procedurally generated. You can if you want to, but we don't. And it also converted the Django choice objects as well and created enums for us. Okay, so how did we do that? Unfortunately, I can't show you the actual code because it's closed source for the time being, and I regret that very much, but one day hopefully it won't be. But what I can do is show you approximately how we did it, wink, wink. So we use this thing called init subclass. This is a special method that most people probably aren't aware of. It's extremely powerful, but also extremely dangerous. Nonetheless, go ahead and do it. So this is a function that's called when the class is first constructed at runtime, or essentially when you do an import statement. It only happens once. For each inherited class that's on that class, it will call the init subclass method as well. As long as you are calling the super method within any overrides, it will continue to change through the MRO list, look it up if you don't know what that is. And the order of inheritance really matters. Think of it as like an injection point enabling modification of the class at runtime. Here is a very trivial example. So we have a print class named Mixin, and it's just going to print the module and the name of the subclass when it gets constructed. And there you go. So silly example prints out subclass into silly name.silly example. Very, very simple, but you get the point. Type is the other one that most people, I guess, aren't probably familiar with. Type is basically, most people would use it to get the class back. So it's just the same as saying object.underscore class. But what you can also do with it is construct objects and class definitions on the fly at runtime. Yeah, so if you take a string and you do that, it'll say it's class string, because everything in Python is an object. Let's do something a little bit more concrete. So let's say we want to make sure that all the classes that are derivative of this thing are uniquely named, right? So we create a registry. We have in the init subclass, we go, is the current class's name in the registry? If not, if it is, throw an error. Otherwise, add it to the registry. Very trivial example, two different pies. We import the first one. We try to port the second one. And of course, we get an error saying, nah, mate, it's already there, right? So it's a way of doing something to standardize your code at runtime and preventing people from doing the same thing twice, or at least doing something the same twice. Let's do something a little bit more complex. If we take the droid types and we define it like this, because Star Wars, and we've got translator, astromech, and soldier, and then we put them into a list, and we have a droid map. We'll come back to that one. This is our mixing class, so this is the thing that's going to be subclassed, and we have a check for the droid type. So by default, it's none, and then we say, if you're going to use this, you have to define it, otherwise you're going to throw an error. And then if you do use it, of course, is it actually a valid type? Otherwise, throw an error. So trivial example again, here we go. We try to import it, notice the astromech doesn't define it, and we get, droid type must be defined when we import it. You'll notice that I also used translator twice and wrote solid droid instead of maybe soldier. Yeah, okay, all right. So let's make sure that that sort of stuff doesn't happen. So we add this to the init subclass again before the super, and we go, okay, is the droid type in the map? If it is, throw an error. Otherwise, register it. So we're just sort of registering things at runtime. So now we fix the astro one, and we do that, and of course we get an error saying, hey, you've tried to register translator twice. But imagine if we had 30 types. We don't want to define 30 classes. That's boring. Let's write the code to do that. So we comment out that code, and now in the same module that droid mixin is in, we're going to reload it at runtime on the fly while it's being constructed. And we loop over our list of droid types, and we use the type method to construct it in a standardized way. Droid.type, capitalize it, droid, so now we have a formulaic class name. We automatically inherit, because we say inherit droid mixin, and then we pass in the original values that we want to assign to any attributes. And then we rebind it back onto the module on the fly using the name that we just constructed. So now when we import, hey, look at that, we get astromech, and it's astromech droid, so it's consistent. Ooh. And it is actually on that module. And it's already assigned its type. And it has actually inherited the droid mixin because we've got a.types, right? In fact, we can loop over that map and we can print it out and we see that we built all of them and they're consistent. Yeah. So that's all I had to say today. What I wanted to show you is that by combining init subclass and type, it's possible to enforce, to some degree, standardization. You can procedurally generate consistent nomenclature, remove excess boilerplate, and for better or for worse, pseudo compiler-like behavior, depending on how you do things. All right, I have to acknowledge my awesome team. They're awesome. Everyone is here except for Richard. And then, of course, the amazing scientists and engineers that actually make the biology work. We're about 85 people and growing. Shameless, shameless plug. We are growing. If you're interested, if anything here sparked your interest, or you know someone who would be, just get in contact. We are actually in Stockholm, not in Södertälje, even though it says on the website. Okay, just FYI. Thank you, and any questions?
There is a question on that side.
Thank you. Really exciting. Of course, this is very powerful. Do you, as you work with this, do you experience any sort of trouble with, you know, finding out where does this class come from? And I mean, since you use this very much, maybe you have some ways of meditating that, or that challenge. How do you approach it?
That's an excellent question. So yeah, every abstraction has a cost, and one of that cost is hiding how things do and making a lot of magic. So for us, the advantage is that someone coming in new can be taught how to do something as long as they follow the design pattern. Everything's really quick to get it done. Right up until something doesn't work, right? And then you've got to understand how it works. And so there is a learning cost to that. And then on top of that, for example, if we were actually using that code, right, for the droids, you need to have a function on your types class that you can just say, okay, make me this class, right? Because it doesn't exist in your code base, so you don't have any type hints or anything. But because it's droid mixin, you can actually respond and say, okay, well, this function returns a droid mixin type. And if you're using types, which you should be using types, you'll have your auto completion. So there are ways around it, but there are indeed costs. We use it because we want to generate our schema without actually writing our schema. And because our schema is only active at runtime, it works for us, right? And the other factor is there's one entry point to Django, right? It's in its settings.py. When settings.py loads, it loads the schema, and that causes the cascade all the way down through the code base that causes everything to compile. If you were not doing something like that, you might run into problems because you're not loading that code at runtime. And so therefore, halfway through your program, it's like, you tried to do something you couldn't do. Right, so.
Hi. Hi. Thanks for the talk. I'm going to go back to the cancer side of things.
Sure.
Out of curiosity, because I didn't quite understand the concept, and for a layman like me, where does Anocca kind of come in the picture if, say, I was a cancer patient and was wanting to get treated?
All right, so assuming that's very far in the future, because you're quite young, you would, in the ideal world, you would come in and the doctor would take a biopsy, and they'd take a blood draw, and they'd go, okay, well, we're going to sequence your genome and figure out what HLAs you have. And then they'll take your cancer and they'll sequence your cancer. And they will detect the little parts, the antigens, that are unique to that cancer. And because it's going to be way in the future that you get that, there'll be a huge database of all the potential antigens and TCR pairings. And you'll go in and the doctor will go, okay, cool, we'll punch it into the Anocca proprietary software. Well, yeah. And it spits out and goes, okay, here are all the TCRs that you can use. And by the way, three of these are off the shelf. So we'll just go out the back and get them, defrost them, pump them into you. Obviously, that's an ideal world. Today, as it is, TCRT is so early that it's last line. We can't put it into you today unless you're really, really sick and you've got no other options. That's how things work in the medical for good reasons. But there is a flavor of this called CAR-T, and they came out around 2010. And it's a more limited version of this. And when it works, it works. 85% remission rate in some cases. And that's a fancy name for curing it. You can never cure cancer, but you can do a really good job of getting rid of it. I hope that answers your question.
No more questions. We have time for one more question, maybe. No?
Cool.
Okay, then I have last question.
Right.
Okay, there is one. There is one.
Hello. I was just wondering for the functionality that init subclass offers, if I understood what it does correctly, if you could do something like that with metaclasses, and if you consider something like that, like possible benefits and downsides?
I'm not actually very familiar with metaclasses, which is why I came up with that solution. quite possibly. I guess I'd have to look it up. I know some aspects of metaclass could definitely use that. Yeah. I like the fact that it's at runtime and you can standardize things. That's the big thing. Yeah. I'm not sure. I suppose you could combine metaclasses with type to automatically generate classes as well.
Then thank you very much, Ryan. Big thanks to all Anocca team for being here and for making it possible. So a round of applause for them one more time.